Jordana, coming live from Virginia, born and raised in Brooklyn, but I'm definitely here to contribute to Sarcaz's collection of topics that she's asked me to give my opinion or my take on as a Black lesbian married woman. So, shout out to the wife, who's out in the kitchen doing some stuff, because I'm hungry, but we about to do this thing. So, the topic is chances. How many is too much? So, there's really three main points that I have for this. So, I'm going to go over the three, and then I'm going to just give you guys some nuggets that go under each one. Number one, set your boundaries and stick to them. And, of course, if you don't know what boundaries are, it's pretty much guidelines in terms of engagement between you and anybody. So, it could be friends, family, loved one, partner, your job, whatever, any type of relationship you may have. You set the boundaries, you set the terms of how you want to be treated and valued in that relationship. So that's number one. Number two is determine how you're treated. You determine that. Nobody else determines that. And the ability to determine the treatment is in how you set your boundaries. If your boundaries are set very far, then chances are you're tolerating a lot more than you may be willing to. But you got to find that balance. Number three is don't feel guilty when you've reached your breaking point. Everybody has one. It's just a matter of how long it takes you to get there based on where you set your boundaries. So one, two, and three are all connected, but I'm going to break down how you can set your boundaries and the best way to make sure when you get to too much, you know that and the other person knows. So first way to set boundaries is to just ponder and write your needs, your wants, and your must-haves. Like I said, this applies to relationships, any type of relationship, with family, friends, a partner, potential partner, job. Take time to write a list with those three categories, your needs, your wants, and your must-haves. This can guide your decision in how you move forward with a particular relationship. And when you have that list, you don't leave it to the unknown or how someone engages with you because you're doing things on your terms. Now, that doesn't make you controlling. That just means you come in knowing what you want and how you want to be treated. You can also use that list and refer to it every time you meet somebody or you think you're interested in someone and you're in conversation with them. You can have a conversation and just have that list in the back of your mind that says, okay, employed, check, gainfully employed, check, life goals, check. That may be on your must-haves list. But when you have that, it keeps you focused. So when you see somebody that you're not really sure if you want to deal with them, you can also use that list to see why you're not interested or why you are interested. Also, you can have that wants list that helps you decide what you can negotiate on. So you may be willing to bargain with someone about something. So they may not be in the exact position in their life that you need someone to be at, but they're in pursuit of that. So you can negotiate on that term. However, if it's someone who doesn't really have an idea, or doesn't really care about long-term goals, whether it's financial, fiscal, physical, then you can say, okay, I can't negotiate on that because that's very important to me. And then you can have something that you're willing to compromise on where a person may have bad credit right now, but they're in stride to fix that. And good credit is on your must-have list. You may be willing to compromise because they're making conscious efforts to improve their credit score. And that's totally fine. Right now, you may see it as a loss because their credit score is not good, but you can foresee it getting better. And in that, you may be willing to lose that on your list. It may be a need, but it may not be a want. It may not be a must-have. And that's totally fine. Like, all of this is up to you as a person. I can't come in, no one can come in and tell you how to navigate your list, how to create your list, what should be on each part of your list. And just as a note, that list will change over time. What you say you need, want, and must have at 25 may be totally different than what you need at 35. And as you change, as you mature and learn about yourself, then you will determine the changes that you need to make on that list. So feel free to continue to cross things out and add things, or just eliminate something because you realize that you don't really want to date somebody with children. Or maybe you think you do. And that's totally fine. Number two, knowing what's on your list literally helps you decide whether you want to negotiate or compromise. When you negotiate, you're communicating with the other person about what you both can bring to the table and how you can make it work. When you're compromising, it's more of a one person or both people are losing something for the sake of being together or being in contract. And compromising may seem more painful because you're losing something. You're giving up something that's probably valuable to you, but you're willing to do it for the sake of a relationship. So, for example, if your partner or your bae, you're not even like officially together, they want to live in the Bronx and you want to live in Manhattan because your job is in Manhattan and the particular location in the Bronx may be too far. You may be willing to compromise and move to the Bronx and not necessarily be happy with it, have a longer commute, but you'll do it for bae. The negotiation would be that you guys decide to live in Upper Manhattan, which is in the middle of Bronx and the lower part of Manhattan. And that way, you neither of you got exactly what you want, but it works for both of you. So that's the main difference. Okay. So, last one. Chances come in respect to compatibility. How do the things or the items in a relationship that may be a concern affect you as a person? And the number of chances varies with each person. So I'm going to break it down. Compatibility is as simple as where a person wants to live in 5 years. What the person's aspirations are for their life. They may want to do the bare minimum and you may be an overachiever. And 10 years from now, you can see that weighing you down as someone who has many aspirations for your life. And that can be an issue in compatibility. It can also be as simple as, where does this person want to live? You may despise the South. They may love the South. And so you know they're going to move. And it's up to you to make the decision on whether or not you want to move forward with the relationship based on that fact. And again, your terms, your life, your decisions. So if that's something you don't want to do, you don't have to guilt trip yourself into giving someone so many chances against your own better judgment and your own well-being. All about chances and too much is up to you. You decide those terms. Empower yourself to determine that. Don't allow anybody to tell you whether you gave them enough chances or not. That is your right to choose. Now, with that said, when it comes to mishaps and behaviors that a person has, you got to just identify in your must-haves, your needs, and your wants, what you're willing to take. If a person comes with a lot of baggage, comes with a lot of negative habits, comes with a lot of unconscious behavior that negatively affects you, you have to determine if that affects you, how much it affects you, and drawing a line between toxic and it being unintentional. Some people do things to intentionally hurt you. Some people do not. But even in both terms, you have to decide, are you going to speak up and address it and expect change, or are you going to walk away? I personally have allowed certain things in my life, in my past, that were toxic, and I didn't have my list to say, you know what, this is not even healthy. And it all started with my self-worth and what I thought I was worthy of, what I should take. And I gave way more chances than I should have. If I knew then what I knew now, as many people say, I would have walked away much sooner because I would have had my list of needs, wants, must-haves, and I would have just looked at it, put it in black and white, and I would have known this is not it. And sometimes we go through that because that's just how life is. You know, we live and we learn, we grow. And when you draw your boundaries, you know what you can take and what you can't. And toxic, everyone uses that term very loosely now, but there are a lot of toxic behaviors. Let's just be honest. You know, lying, stealing, cheating, we know those as toxic. But the very subtle ones are going silent or going ghost when a person is upset with you. Like, silent treatment is toxic. That's parents, friends, family, anything. Silent treatment is toxic. It's abusive. It can be, especially when you're a person like me who's had issues with abandonment. So you have to know yourself to know where your level of toxic versus unconscious behavior is. You may not be able to tolerate loud tones of voices. You may not like screaming. And if a person's first reaction is to scream and be aggressive and be angry towards you, that can become toxic. And you should be able to know that for yourself so you can skip out. Not sit around and wait for it to get better because, you know, they're working through something. Like, all of that, all those excuses are what's pushing your boundaries back. And eventually, when you meet that boundary and you get to that breaking point, you know you've got to too much chances. So the number of chances varies among each person. In my past, I've given a lot of chances, like way too many chances. I've dated someone and they had a whole ex that they were still entertaining. And I broke it off when I realized that this ex was calling my phone and threatening me. Me? Anybody that knows me, you know I ain't tolerating that shit now. Absolutely not. No way, no how. But at that time, that's what I tolerated because I was giving them the benefit of the doubt that they were being truthful and they were really trying to end the situation. But when I realized that they weren't, I broke it off. Now, some would say, yeah, so there you go. You got the boundary. They had too many chances. Right. But then I took you back. A couple months later, I took you back. That's where I went wrong. Should have never did that. Blessing in disguise, in a sense, because if that time didn't pass with that person, I wouldn't have done the amount of self-evaluation and self-healing and discovery that I did to prepare me for the amazing wife that I have now. So you can decide on your number of chances for each person. It can be different. Just understand that the time that you're spending giving a lot of chances to someone that you know is not compatible and you know doesn't have a lot of the things on that list, which is why that's very important, is the time that's passing that you could be meeting someone who is compatible and who does have a lot of things on your list. So for anybody that's in a relationship given tons and tons of chances on the same shit that ain't changed since day one or day two or week three, just think. Who's out there that could be compatible and is waiting for you? Don't know it, but you may both be in situations that you really could not be in. But we're sitting here giving a lot of chances and protecting your mental, your physical health, your emotional health is all that matters. At the end of the day, you gotta value yourself. You gotta value what you want out of your life and make sure that you hold that as a priority. So when you write your list of must-haves, needs, and wants, that you are the center of that. Not your family's decision for you, not your friends' decisions for you, but what you want, what you see in yourself. And don't forget, you write those lists, get their list. Get the other person's list. Just like when you go on an interview and you know, you have your idea of what the company may be and what they may be presenting. You go in looking for things that you can benefit from, room for growth, salary, time off, schedule. All of those things are your must-haves, your needs, and your wants. You do the same thing. Do it in relationships. I guarantee you that when you write that list down and it's in black and white, your mind that will give you emotions and all these other nuances to make you feel like, you know, this person could be awesome. When you write things down in black and white and you look at them sometimes, it eliminates all that emotional shit. Because your emotions will have you looking past a big green elephant sitting in the middle of the doorway between you and this person. You will totally ignore it until you look at the paper and you say, you know what? On paper, we don't even work. That's all I got for y'all. I hope this helps. You know, hope you guys are staying safe in quarantine. Sarcast, shout out to you again for reaching out. And I'll see y'all on the next week.